verses 6-16. 4. The cure and the circumstances of it briefly related, v. 6-9. Jesus saw him lie. Observe, when Christ came up to Jerusalem he visited not the palaces, but the hospitals, which is an instance of his humility and condescension and tender compassion, and an indication of his great design in coming into the world, which was to seek and save the sick and wounded. There was a great multitude of poor cripples here at Bethesda, but Christ fastened his eye upon this one, and singled him out from the rest, because he was senior of the house, and in a more deplorable condition than any of the rest, and Christ delights to help the helpless, and hath mercy on whom he will have mercy. Perhaps his companions in tribulation insulted over him, because he had often been disappointed of a cure, therefore Christ took him for his patient. It is his honor to side with the weakest, and bear up those whom he sees run down. He knew and considered how long he had lain in this condition. Those that have been long in affliction may comfort themselves with this, that God keeps account how long, and knows our frame. He asked him, "Wilt thou be made whole?" A strange question to be asked one that had been so long ill. Some indeed would not be made whole, because their sores serve them to beg by and serve them for an excuse for idleness, but this poor man was as unable to go a-begging as to work, yet Christ put it to him to express his own pity and concern for him. Christ is tenderly inquisitive concerning the desires of those that are in affliction, and is willing to know what is their petition, "What shall I do for you?" To try him whether he would be beholden for a cure to him against whom the great people were so prejudiced and sought to prejudice others. To teach him to value the mercy, and to excite in him desires after it. In spiritual cases, people are not willing to be cured of their sins, are loath to part with them. If this point therefore were but gained, if people were willing to be made whole, the work were half done, for Christ is willing to heal, if we be but willing to be healed. Mt 8:3. The poor impotent man takes this opportunity to renew his complaint, and to set forth the misery of his case, which makes his cure the more illustrious. "Sir, I have no man to put me into the pool," v. 7. He seems to take Christ's question as an imputation of carelessness and neglect. "If thou hadst had a mind to be healed, thou wouldest have looked better to thy hits, and have got into the healing waters long before now." "No, Master," saith the poor man, "it is not for want of a good will, but of a good friend, that I am unhealed. I have done what I could to help myself, but in vain, for no one else will help me." He does not think of any other way of being cured than by these waters, and desires no other friendship than to be helped into them. Therefore, when Christ cured him, his imagination or expectation could not contribute to it, for he thought of no such thing. He complains for want of friends to help him in, "I have no man, no friend to do me that kindness." One would think that some of those who had been themselves healed should have lent him a hand, but it is common for the poor to be destitute of friends, no man careth for their soul. To the sick and impotent it is as true a piece of charity to work for them as to relieve them, and thus the poor are capable of being charitable to one another, and ought to be so, though we seldom find that they are so. I speak it to their shame. He bewails his infelicity, that very often when he was coming another stepped in before him. But a step between him and a cure, and yet he continues impotent. None had the charity to say, "Your case is worse than mine, do you go in now, and I will stay till the next time," for there is no getting over the old maxim, "Every one for himself." Having been so often disappointed, he begins to despair. And now is Christ's time to come to his relief. He delights to help in desperate cases. Observe, how mildly this man speaks of the unkindness of those about him, without any peevish reflections. As we should be thankful for the least kindness, so we should be patient under the greatest contempts, and, let our resentments be ever so just, yet our expressions should ever be calm. And observe further, to his praise, that, though he had waited so long in vain, yet still he continued lying by the pool side, hoping that some time or other help would come, Hab 2:3. Our Lord Jesus hereupon cures him with a word speaking, though he neither asked it nor thought of it. Here is the word he said, "Rise, take up thy bed," v. 8. He is bidden to rise and walk, a strange command to be given to an impotent man, that had been long disabled, but this divine word was to be the vehicle of a divine power. It was a command to the disease to be gone, to nature to be strong, but it is expressed as a command to him to bestir himself. He must rise and walk, that is, attempt to do it, and in the essay he should receive strength to do it. The conversion of a sinner is the cure of a chronic disease. This is ordinarily done by the word, a word of command, arise, and walk, turn, and live, make ye a new heart, which no more supposes a power in us to do it, without the grace of God, distinguishing grace, than this supposed such a power in the impotent man. But, if he had not attempted to help himself, he had not been cured, and he must have borne the blame, yet it does not therefore follow that, when he did rise and walk, it was by his own strength, no, it was by the power of Christ, and he must have all the glory. Observe, Christ did not bid him rise and go into the waters, but rise and walk. Christ did that for us which the law could not do, and set that aside. He is bidden to take up his bed. First, to make it to appear that it was a perfect cure, and purely miraculous, for he did not recover strength by degrees, but from the extremity of weakness and impotency he suddenly stepped into the highest degree of bodily strength, so that he was able to carry as great a load as any porter that had been as long used to it as he had been disused. He, who this minute was not able to turn himself in his bed, the next minute was able to carry his bed. The man sick of the palsy, MT 9:6, was bidden to go to his house, but probably this man had no house to go to, the hospital was his home, therefore he is bidden to rise and walk. Secondly, it was to proclaim the cure, and make it public, for, being the Sabbath day, whoever carried a burden through the streets made himself very remarkable, and everyone would inquire what was the meaning of it, thereby notice of the miracle would spread, to the honor of God. Thirdly, Christ would thus witness against the tradition of the elders, which had stretched the law of the Sabbath beyond its intention, and would likewise show that he was Lord of the Sabbath, and had power to make what alterations he pleased about it, and to overrule the law. Joshua, and the host of Israel, marched about Jericho on the Sabbath day, when God commanded them, so did this man carry his bed, in obedience to a command. The case may be such that it may become a work of necessity, or mercy, to carry a bed on the Sabbath day, but here it was more, it was a work of piety, being designed purely for the glory of God. Fourthly, he would hereby try the faith and obedience of his patient. By carrying his bed publicly, he exposed himself to the censure of the ecclesiastical court, and was liable, at least, to be scourged in the synagogue. Now, will he run the hazard of this, in obedience to Christ? Yes, he will. Those that have been healed by Christ's word should be ruled by his word, whatever it cost them. The efficacy of this word, v9, a divine power went alone with it, and immediately he was made whole, took up his bed, and walked. He felt the power of Christ's word healing him, immediately he was made whole. What a joyful surprise was this to the poor cripple, to find himself all of a sudden so easy, so strong, so able to help himself. What a new world was he in an instant. Nothing is too hard for Christ to do. He obeyed the power of Christ's word commanding him. He took up his bed and walked, and did not care who blamed him or threatened him for it. The proof of our spiritual cure is our rising and walking. Hath Christ healed our spiritual diseases? Let us go whithersoever he sends us, and take up whatever he is pleased to lay upon us, and walk before him. What became of the poor man after he was cured? We are here told. What passed between him and the Jews who saw him carry his bed on the Sabbath day, for on that day this cure was wrought, and it was the Sabbath that fell within the Passover week, and therefore a high day, ch. 19:31. Christ's work was such that he needed not make any difference between Sabbath days and other days, for he was always about his Father's business, but he wrought many remarkable cures on that day, perhaps to encourage his church to expect those spiritual favors from him, in their observance of the Christian Sabbath, which were typified by his miraculous cures. Now here,